controlled fear. The fear of the murderer disposing of the body, which would give deadly evidence against...
I laid the carpet in the backyard and threw about 20 or 30 buckets of water on it to try to wash the blood off. And the colour of the water that came off was like blood.
Next thing I remember was something scratching and pulling at my mouth. I opened my eyes, and Jean was lying there under me, and I had my hands around her throat.
Murder Most Foul. Six classic murder cases presented by Nick Ross. Case 1, The Surgeon's Knife.
Members of the jury, on the 29th of September 1935, Miss Susan Johnston was walking along the Moffat Edinburgh Road near Garden Home Lynn Bridge. As she was crossing the bridge, she did what many people do. She looked down into the gully below and saw what she thought was an arm lying in the bed of the stream. She went back to the hotel. There she saw her brother, and as a result of what she said to him, the brother went down to the water's edge and saw a forearm and head which were wrapped, or partly wrapped, in newspaper.
That was how Mr. Justice Singleton began his summing up at the Manchester Assizes on Friday, the 13th of March, 1935. The jury had to concern itself with bits and pieces of human bodies. And so shall we, because this was one of the first cases in which scientific and medical evidence was to play a central part. Subsequent searches by the police discovered well over 50 portions of body, or rather bodies. A second head was found. The grisly job of reassembling these human jigsaws was carried out by a team led by Professor John Glaister, the Regius Professor of Forensic Medicine at Glasgow University.
Exhibit 135 contains photographs of what I've termed head number one. It can be seen that the eyes have been removed, some facial skin, the tissues of the nose. You will also notice the removal of two central teeth. Exhibit 139 shows the head of body number two. The tissue was removed to a greater extent than in number one. As in the other body, the eyes had been removed, the skin of the face, the soft tissues of the nose. Also, both ears, nearly all the scalp tissues bearing hair, the lips, and a portion of the tongue had been...
And so it went on. The prosecution would describe the bodies as having been horribly mutilated. But there was more to it than that. And if they could indeed be said to have been mutilated, well, the mutilation had been done by an expert. For instance, they hadn't been crudely chopped up, but disarticulated. That is to say, surgically severed at suitable joints.
Professor Glaister, this disarticulation... would this require any surgical skill?
Indeed it would, my lord, and definite anatomical knowledge.
What kind of knife would be required?
Probably a Symes amputation knife and an ordinary scalpel. In the case of body number two, about 5 hours would be needed to complete the work.
And how long had the bodies been in the river? Some of the pieces of flesh were wrapped in a torn sheet, others in a blouse. One of the heads was in a child's romper suit. But other remains were found wrapped in newspapers. These were of various dates from early August onwards. The most recent was the Sunday Graphic of September the 15th, just a fortnight prior to their discovery. Scotland Yard's Black Museum still holds copies of the fragments of that Sunday Graphic. There's part of the front page numbered and dated September the 15th, 1935. It seems the great attraction was Lady Londonderry's frank memoirs. One of the other scraps is torn from an inside page. There's half a photograph of a line of young women and what's left of the headline, which reads AMBE apostrophe S, Carnival Queen Crowned. That headline was to save the police months of sifting through files of missing persons. To return to the trial.
I am Edwin Vaughan Morris. I'm circulation manager of the Sunday Graphic and News newspaper. These sections of newspaper shown to me are from a special slip or local edition of the Sunday Graphic of the 15th of September, 1935, of which 3,700 copies were printed. They were circulated only in Morecambe, Lancaster and the immediate vicinity, and they contain photographs of the crowning of Morecambe's Carnival Queen.
At once, the investigation shifted to Morecambe, the seaside resort, and the nearby ancient town of Lancaster, which in 1935 had 40,000 inhabitants. Among them was an Indian doctor, probably the only Indian doctor in Lancaster at that time. He lived in a dour, three-storey, respectable, stone-fronted house at No. 2 Dalton Square. He was, by all accounts, an able general practitioner and popular with his patients. But recently, the doctor, whose name was Buck Ruxton, had been behaving rather strangely, as reported by a detective called John Thomas Moffat.
I'm a detective inspector in the Lancashire County Constabulary stationed at Blackburn. On September the 24th, I was in the Lancaster police office investigating the death of a Mrs. Smalley. One of those I interviewed was Mrs. Kerwin, who works part-time for Dr. Ruxton. Between 3 and 4 in the afternoon, Dr. Ruxton himself came to the police station, though I had not requested to see him.
Look here, Inspector Moffat. What the hell do the police want making inquiries about my private affairs for? I do not know Mrs. Smalley. I have enough trouble on my mind. Come across and search my house and interview the whole damn lot of us. It is nothing but professional jealousy. I am the most progressive doctor in this town. I have over 2,000 patients on my panel, and every doctor is jealous of me.
At that point, he held up his hand. His little finger was heavily bandaged, and the bandage twisted round his hand at the same time.
Look at my finger. I cut that and almost severed it with a fruit tin I was opening for my children last week. I'm the most miserable man on earth. My wife leaves me. Now you come bothering me. I come home from visiting my patients a fortnight ago. I go to my study and call her name. No answer. I go to her room. I find a note. It says, I am going away, don't worry. Leaves me with 3 kids crying for their mother, and I do not know where she is. I know nothing about Mrs. Smalley. It is professional jealousy. And you will hear more about it.
Nobody had ever imagined him to be involved in Mrs. Smalley's death. But it was true, Dr. Ruxton's wife had disappeared. Except that she wasn't his wife, they were never married. And it wasn't a fortnight before, but only a week ago, the day Dr. Ruxton had cut his hand, September the 15th. And on the same day, their maidservant, Mary Rogerson, had also disappeared. She was 20. She always visited her father and her stepmother in Morecambe every weekend. On October the 1st, when she'd failed to visit them for 3 weekends running, they informed the police.
My name is Agnes Oxley, and I'm employed as charwoman at the Ruxtons. It was some time after the two women had disappeared that the doctor, who was in bed, called me to his bedside. He asked me to sit down, and he read out an account of the Ravine murder in the Daily Express. He said, "So you see, Mrs. Oxley, it is a man and a woman. It's not our two." I replied that I hope not. He then began to laugh.
On the 11th of October, Dr. Ruxton finally went to see Captain Van, the Chief Constable of Lancaster, to report his wife missing. Later, he returned with a copy of the Daily Express, which had continued covering the story, and he even mentioned the missing Mary Rogerson.
Look here, my dear Van. Can't you do something about these newspaper reports? Look at this. This newspaper says that this woman has a full set of teeth in the lower jaw. And I know to my own knowledge that Mary Rogerson had at least 4 teeth missing in this jaw.
He'd been calm till then, my lord, but now he became excited. He waved his arms about, he sat on the table with his feet on the chair, and he began to bang on the chair in a very violent manner. His conduct was very extraordinary.
It is all the fault of that damn Bobby Edmondson. Captain Van, he's ruining my home. He's having an affair with my belle, my wife, I know it!
He came to see me next day at 9:30 in the evening. He remained at the police station overnight and, at my request, wrote out an account of his movements from the 14th to the 30th of September. He also made and signed a voluntary statement, which he dictated and afterwards corrected and initialed.
The statement is true.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.